So we will begin our session on fiscal policy, sanctions, ecology, and growth cycles. We have four papers. So the first presentation will be by our colleague from Iran, and you're Zeina, right? Zeina will present the impact of smart and non-smart sanctions on government health expenditure, and it's an evidence from developing resource-based countries. Over to you, Zeina. You have 15 minutes for presentation. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, let me share you the screen. Do you have my screen?
Don't you see?
Can you see my screen?
Not yet. It's not shared.
Okay, I want to talk about the impact of smart and non-smart sanctions on government health expenditure, evidence from developing resource-based countries. Since the 20th century, economic sanctions have been considered as a common foreign policy tool. They act as an alternative or a complement to military action to change the political behavior of a target country. Economic sanctions have been frequently used by different countries and intergovernmental organizations for self-interested or humanitarian concerns to deal with issues such as human rights violations, democratizations, and so on. According to some case studies in Cuba, Haiti, Iraq, and etc., the traditional trade sanctions demolish the public health. Besides, by considering the weakness of sanctions in achieving their foreign policy ambitions, this question raises that whether the humanitarian cost of sanctions are worth the consequences. It's widely accepted that the design of sanctions need to be improved and their humanitarian cost to ordinary citizens minimized as far as possible. Following these concerns, in order to maximize the impact of sanctions on political leaders and at the same time reducing humanitarian damages for the civilian population, policymakers have tried to design the concept of targeted sanctions or a smart sanction, which include arm embargoes, financial sanctions on the assets of individuals and companies, travel restrictions on the leaders, and also trade sanctions on particular goods. So there is a necessity to investigate the validity of the claim. And now we should have a comparison between the effect of smart and non-smart sanctions on the health sector. In what way sanctions can damage the health sector? Since all of the sanctions regime now consider humanitarian exemptions for food and medicine, the effect of sanctions on the health sector are often indirect. In other words, sanctions directly affect the available resources and allocation decisions that are taken as a result of economic constraint. Consequently, health spending can be expected to decrease. To what extent are a country's source of income affected by sanctions? It heavily depends on the situation of export and import of that country. The dependence on export earnings of one or more easily monetizable products is a disadvantage for targeted countries that make them more vulnerable towards sanctions.
Zainab, we can't see your slides.
Can you see them?
No,
we can't see them.
Let me try it again.
Is the option there, Chair?
Can you see them?
Yes, absolutely. Just move.
Okay, excuse me. We have this situation in developing resource export economies. In single product economies, resource revenues are the main source of financial government expenditure and imports of products. So the country's revenue can be easily identified and blocked, and more revenue restrictions, more effective sanctions. In the second phase, sanctions represent an economic shock to target countries, so they affect targets' government's decision-making environment, forcing them to reallocate government spending And due to the unequal distribution of limited revenues, governments may protect some sectors like defense from budget cuts at the expense of decreases in spending for low priority policy area like health. The question is, what happened after reducing health budget? Such a decline in health spending can lead to a decrease in disease prevention services, and the emergency needs will be prioritized. And another one is the neglect of health sector infrastructures, and also it can lead to reducing imports of health products.
Zainab, I'm sorry, your slides are not advancing. We can't, it's just the title slide.
Excuse
or maybe the
me?
Third, sixth slide. Sixth, you're on the sixth.
Oh, I would think that connection is interrupted. Can you hear me?
We can. And you are on hypothesis slide right now?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, we can see.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks, Amanda.
Okay. The first one is comprehensive non-smart sanctions decrease government health expenditures. And the second one is smart sanctions do not have detrimental impact on government health expenditure. Because of time limitation and escape from the literature, about the data description, we utilized panel data for 46 developing resource-based countries over the period of 2000 to 2016. As discussed earlier, the sanctions are more likely to influence the government spending behavior of the resource-based countries through affecting their resource revenues. So our calculations reveal that the global average of natural resource rents during the period of this study is equal to 7.71%. Therefore, our sample comprises those developing countries which their average natural resource rents are above this amount. About the dependent variable, to check the robustness of our result, we use three type of government health expenditure. The first one is as a percentage of GDP, the second one is as a percentage of general government expenditure, and the final is in per capita form. About the independent variable. Obviously, we have two types of sanctions, smart and non-smart sanctions. And also we consider three main centers for every type of sanctions, US, EU, and other members of UN. And for each type of center, sanction variable is graded on 0 to 3 scale, where zero represents the absence of sanctions by that particular sender, and 3 shows the most severe sanctions, which means all 3 elements of it have inputs. We should add these initials sanctions variable together to get the final variable with appropriate weights of each sender. Let's take a back. What are the weights in previous equation? According to the literature, the relative size of economic of the sender can important in determining the effectiveness and outcome of the sanction. Therefore, we use GDP of each sender in calculating weights. And also to check the robustness of our results, we use a variable and fixed weight, that both of them are based on the ratio of sender's GDP to the UN's GDP. By replacing them into the previous equation, we have two types of...
Sena, sorry to disturb you, but the slide is stuck at hypothesis. We need to go to the 12th slide, no? We can't see your slide. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Now it's fine. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Okay. We have two types of sanction variable, with variable weights and with fixed weight. About the control variable, the first one is lag value of government health expenditure. We include it and we use it to correct the autoregressive process of our dependent variable. Government health expenditures are most likely to remain constant due to the lack of dramatic fluctuation in health worker of the country, or the high stability of maintenance cost of health infrastructure. And moreover, inclusion of this variable can help us to control the control for some excluded but potentially important variable in the model. The next one is democracy and political violence, economic wealth, natural resource rents, and corruption. About the methodology. Since we are faced with panel data and we use a one-year lag of our dependent variables, so we use a GMM method, and also in order to avoid spurious regression model, we want to be sure about the stationarity of our variables, so we apply some unit root test, and the results reveal that all of variables, at least in one of these mentioned tests, are stationary. And also we to sum up, to check the robustness of our results, we consider two type of sanction variable, two type of political violence in indices, and two type of natural resource rent proxies. Also we use logarithmic form of variable. We have three type of regression. The first one is investigating the impact of sanctions on general government health expenditure as a percentage of GDP. And also we have four models here. The first one is, in the first one, we use smart and non-smart sanctions with variable weight, and also internal conflict and external conflict as our proxies for political violence. And in the second one, we replace our conflict proxies with another one, AC total, which is the major episodes of political violence. And the third model and the fourth one is we use smart and non-smart sanctions with fixed weight. As can be seen, government health expenditure 1 year lag have a positive and significant coefficient in all of our model that provide a strong support for a dynamic process of government health expenditure. And also turning to the sanction variable, a smart sanction in with both variable and fixed weight have a positive and significant effect on the health expenditure. And on the other hand, non-smart sanction have a negative and significant effect in all the models that confirm our expectation about the detrimental impact of non-smart sanctions on health sector. And also about the internal conflict and external conflicts, I should mention that the higher score of this index are it reflects the lower amounts of risk for political violence. So the sign of these two variables with AC total is in opposite. And about the J statistic and the probability of it, we use instrumental variable in the process of estimating GMM method, and our instrumental variable should be valid. And the probability of J statistic shows that our instrumental variable are right. The next one is the impact of sanctions on government health expenditure as a percentage of general government health expenditure.
1 minute left. Okay, wind up. Just 1 minute left.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
The obtained result is approximately similar to previous table. More precisely about the smart sanction, it's have a positive and significant effect in all model, but non-smart sanctions here just are significant in models that using variable weights. And the prob-of-J statistic confirms the validity of our instrument. And the final one, the impact of sanctions on general government health expenditure per capita. That based on our expectations and consistent with the previous regression, the smart sanctions have a positive and significant effect on government health expenditure, and non-smart sanctions have a negative one. And we can have a comparison between AC total variable and non-smart sanction variable. If you look at the coefficient, you can find that the detrimental impact of non-smart sanction is far worse than political violence. So this suggests that smart sanction, comprehensive sanctions cannot have been a humane alternative to war. So in conclusion, In the literature, the studies that have been done so far are often anecdotal case studies, and in some cases, panel data without any distinctions between smart and non-smart traditional sanctions. We expanded our scope and studied the human cost of sanctions in developing resource-based countries where the resource revenues play a key role in the influencing the government spending on health and non-health sector. And as can be seen, smart sanctions have a positive effect on domestic general government health expenditure as a percentage of GDP, also as a percentage of general government health expenditure, and in per capita form. And a non-smart sanction have an adverse effect on them. A smart sanction may be less effective, but more human than traditional trade sanction. Thank you for your listening.
So much. And now I invite Magusha George to discuss Zainab's paper.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Zainab, for such a very enlightening presentation. The smart and non-smart sanctions with respect to the health expenditure, I feel, is very relevant, especially in this period of pandemic where we have witnessed many heart-breaking instances on the wake of COVID-19. Smart sanctions is, in fact, the need of the hour, so that it won't affect the civic life of the common man. The distinction between...
I can't hear your voice.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, I was saying that the smart sanctions is actually the very need of the hour, that so that it will not affect the civic life of the common man, as you have rightly mentioned. So the distinction between the smart and non-smart sanctions and their impact on health expenditures have been very clearly brought out in your work, and I really appreciate that. But I have a few clarificatory questions that I would like to ask you. First of all, I think you have in your paper, you have mentioned that you have been working with 46 developing economies. But I think it would be great if you can mention a few major economies at least which have come in the categories. Also, secondly, I'd like to have more clarity on the categorization based on the resource rent. Is it a global standard of classifying the things of economies on this basis? And whether there is some other categories which you can say like above this rent is classified as some other category. And thirdly, can we relate this classification in any way with the economic classification in terms of GDP? Can we find a similarity between these two classifications? And finally, I just want to know if I think you have done your analysis as for the panel as a whole. So have you ever considered the country specific effects in this regard? Like if how each country have, whether there is a country specific features that has influenced the sanctions and their impact on health expenditures. Thank you.
Thank you, Magusha. Yeah, Zainab, can I suggest something? We will go ahead with the presentations and you think about it and respond to the, you know, the questions from the floor and also the questions from Magusha at the end, so that, you know, after all the presentations. Okay? Yeah. So I'll go ahead with the next presentation. That's debt sustainability, empirical evidence from BRICS countries by Magusha. Thank you. All of you can respond to the questions by the discussant, and I open the floor last 20 minutes. Then you come and talk around 1 to 2 minutes. Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Zainab. Yeah. Go ahead, Magusha.
Thank you, ma'am. Can I share my screen now?
Sure. We can't hear you, Magusha. Now I can.
Can you see my screen, ma'am?
But
the PPT, ma'am, I just want to.
Yeah, I can see your public debt sustainability. Yeah, you're there.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Good morning, all. First of all, I would like to thank for this opportunity to present our work. This is actually a preliminary analysis that we have done with respect to my PhD work. So to begin with, we can say that public debt is very important measure in financing the resource gaps for the governments. So in order to achieve the different sustainable goals, the governments are required to mobilize a huge amount of resources, and most often the governments are unable to mobilize these resources internally. Public debt revolves around these resource gaps where the expenditure requirements are exceeding that of revenue. Borrowing helps the governments to accomplish their different social and developmental goals. Prudent utilization of public debt leads to higher economic growth and adds to capacity to service and repay the external and domestic debt. Debt arises as a problem when the debt servicing capacity does not keep up in pace with the growth of debt. So according to World Bank, as long as the debt outstanding and debt service ratio do not change in a steady state economy, debt can be considered to be sustainable. IMF has given a different view that as long as the debt does not exceed the individual government's ability to service the debt, debt can be considered to be sustainable. When we look at the different approaches, the early studies of debt sustainability made use of the Domer condition, that when the primary deficit or debt path can be considered sustainable, when the real rate of the real growth of the economy is higher than the real interest rate. This condition was later extended by adding other indicators of growth, liquidity, creditworthiness, etc., and later evolved as an indicator approach. So if you look at the major approaches, it began with the unit growth approach, which is utilized in the similar work done by Hamilton and Clavin in 1986, evolved to co-integration approach, indicator approach, one of the most recent
Mangusha, some disturbance over there, somebody's crying.
Sorry, ma'am.
No problem. I was just worried about that.
Is it too much disturbance, ma'am?
No, it's not disturbance. Is it your baby?
It's my sister's baby, ma'am. Sorry.
Okay, she's there. Okay, go ahead. Yeah, I thought that your baby's with somebody else.
No.
Yeah, okay.
So here I've given a brief summary of the some of the works, literature which has used the Bond framework for the analysis of debt sustainability, which I'm not going into much detail at this time. Coming to the objective of the study, the objective is to empirically test whether the public debt and external debt has been sustainable for BRICS countries using Bond framework and the penalized plan technique for time series data. Now, BRICS, the term BRIC has Brazil, Russia, India, and China. This is, in fact, an acronym which was coined by O'Neill in 2001. And subsequently, the South Africa was added to this block in 2010. As we can see from this economies, these are some of the most leading emerging economies we can see, which have the potential of for rapid economic growth, industrialization, and have the potential to bring out a drastic change in the global economy. The BRICS countries' importance can be understood clearly from the fact that it constitutes 43% of the world's total population, more than a quarter of world's landmass, 45% of the world's total labor force, 40% of the share in world's total mercantile trade, and 32% of the world's total GDP purchase in terms of purchasing power parity. However, despite this, the BRICS economies face a major challenge to maintain their robust and sustainable growth along with the macroeconomic stability. So requirements in investments in human capital, flow of foreign investment, technology transfers, developing indigenous innovative capabilities, etc. The major challenge in this regard is the inadequacy of capital. So these economies are resorting much more to borrowing resources. So which can be here, the diagram is a bit, I'm not sure if you're able to clearly comprehend the chart, but we can say that except for Russia, all other economies, Brazil, India, China, and South Africa are having a showing a trend towards increasing in borrowings and also high levels of debt. So before moving on to the methodology and data, I would like to say a few words about bond model, which we have adopted in this study. So bond constructed a general equilibrium stochastic model to test whether the primary surplus GDP ratio is positive or at least a linearizing function. So it shows that if with an increase in debt, there should be an increase in primary surplus as well. So if the coefficient of this is positive and statistically significant, then the debt can be considered to be sustainable. Also, we can say that also born later in 1998, he utilized the Barrow's tax smoothing hypothesis, where and he developed a physical rule, a physical reaction function, which can be stated as ST is equal to alpha plus psi dt plus phi 1 y bar t plus phi 2 g bar t and epsilon t, where y bar and g bar are the business cycle indicators. Y bar shows the deviation from their revenues, which here we consider as the GDP here, and G bar shows fluctuations from this primary spending. So this is calculated by using the HP filter. To adapt this physical rule into a nonlinear context, the coefficient of debt is given as psi t, which indicates that it is a time varying factor. Coming to the methodology specified for this for our work, in order to test the public debt sustainability, we have in fact adopted the nonlinear functional form given by the bond in his model. So except the only change here is that instead of ST, we have considered primary balance as PBT, or else and the dependent variables, the major dependent variables here we consider is DT minus 1, which is the debt to GDP ratio in year T minus 1. We are considering the lag, so that the endogeneity problem will be taken into care. And or EDT minus 1 is the external debt to GDP ratio. So whether we are considering the debt GDP ratio or external debt GDP ratio depends on the relation that we are trying to understand. Y bar and G bar variables are business cycle variables, which have been computed using the HP filter. In order to estimate the nonlinearity in the primary balance debt relation, penalized spline technique is used. This allows in estimating the reaction coefficient psi t in above equation as a function of time, showing how the coefficient evolves over time. The variables used here are primary balance to GDP ratio, lag of debt to GDP, lag of external debt to GDP, GVAR and YVAR. The major sources of data are the World Economic Outlook database from IMF, the World Development Indicators by the World Bank, the historical public debt database by the IMF. The data has been collected for the period 1992-2018, but as we are considering the lag for debt and external debt, the actual period of study is from 1993 to 2018. Coming to the results, this gives a descriptive statistics of the study variables. Here the values are given are the mean and standard deviation. Standard deviation is given in the parentheses. Moving on to the main results of the study, public debt sustainability analysis for BRICS countries using P-spline estimation results. Here, let's first have a look at the YVAR and GVAR variables. YVAR is in fact the real GDP. I said that it is a deviation from the revenue, but for revenue, we have been considering the GDP. So we can say that we expect that if an economy's GDP is growing above a normal level, then it should have a positive impact on the primary balance. It should create a surplus in the economy. Similarly, if the primary expenditure, this is the expenditure which is exclusive of the interest payments. Impact the primary surplus. And as expected, the result shows that Y bar is positive and G bar is that Y bar is significant in all five economies. But when we are coming to G VAR is negative for Brazil, but it is insignificant in the case of Brazil. The main variable of our interest is the lag debt to GDP ratio, DT minus 1. Here we can see that all economies except Russia gives us a positive coefficient. which means that there is a possibility that debt can be sustainable. But in that case also, when we look at the case of India, we can see that the values given in the parenthesis here is the T values. So when we look at the T values, we can see that for India, though the coefficient is positive, it is insignificant. So from this table, we can conclude that for Brazil, China and South Africa, the public debt is sustainable. But in the case of Russia and India, public debt is unsustainable. Another important result here is that given in the row EDF. Here, EDF is the estimated degrees of freedom. This gives the estimate of the smoothening term. This helps us to understand whether there is a time varying, it helps to estimate the time varying coefficient, time variance of the coefficient. So we can say that this can be more clear from this chart. From this chart, we can see that the two stashed lines given is the 95% confidence interval, and the solid line shows the deviation from the average value given in our result tables. The deviation from this average value for every particular area for an economy. So whenever the economy is deviating from the coefficient that we have received, it gives that movement for every year. So when we see at this chart, we can say that the coefficient have been time varying. It has not been constant over the time. So there has been some fluctuations that was happening in the economy. So for Brazil, we can say that there has been a continuous decline in this
coefficient. One more minute.
So moving on to the next result regarding the external debt sustainability. We can here also the Y bar and G bar variables have given the required sign, but we can see that in the case of Brazil, both Y bar and G bar are insignificant, but for all other four economies, Y bar and G bar are significant as giving the expected results. When we are considering the lag external debt GDP ratio, we can say that except for India and China, the other three economies are giving a negative sign, which clearly indicates that the external debt is unsustainable in these economies. And here in China, in case of China and India, external debt is sustainable. Here also, coming to the EDF values, we can see that the constant have been varying over the time period. It has not been constant over the period. So coming to the conclusion, public debt is sustainable for Brazil, China and South Africa. And for Russia and India, the public debt is unsustainable. In case of external debt, for India and China, the external debt is sustainable. But for Brazil, Russia and South Africa, the external debt was unsustainable. For all five nations, the reaction coefficient has not stayed constant over the time. That is, it is time varying. Thank you.
So much. Perfect. I have a quick question, but I'll ask in the end, I think, about the HP filter and about the financing pattern of deficit. You mentioned that external debt, you know, it's insignificant in the context of India. Let us listen to, Matthew Koshy first, and, you can respond to it at the end.
Sure.
Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, Matthew.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning, all. First of all, I would like to congratulate both the authors for this excellent work. And if I have to analyze the paper in just two lines due to the time constraint, I would say that this paper analyzes the public debt sustainability in BRICS countries during 1992 to 2018 using the Bonn model framework, and the penalized line estimation is also done. Also, the estimation of external debt sustainability is also attempted in this paper. And the charts and tables presented were also very digestive and deserve much appreciation. And Magulsha, you have delivered a very nice presentation as well.
And
debt sustainability itself is a very hot topic in this time of COVID pandemic. And you have given a picture of the state of affairs prior to the impact of COVID. That is till 2018 is your time period, right? So clubbing the external debt analysis together helped to give a clear picture as well. Also, there are not many studies which I could find using which have used penalized line method, especially in debt analysis. And this study stands out that way also. But one remark which I would ask, however, is that you assume that the factors influencing primary balance is same for each country, right? So, and you have done a time series analysis. So, wouldn't it be much interesting to look at country specific factors which affects the public debt and see if the sustainability analysis gives the same results? Yeah, that could be one suggestion from mine. And yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew. So Magusha, you prepare your answers and I will give you time in the end. And let's go ahead with the presentation by Matthew on regime switching, fiscal policy and growth cycles. Go ahead, Matthew, your presentation.
I hope my screen is visible.
It's visible, yeah.
Thank you. So once again, good morning all. Yeah, I would like to thank the organizers for this opportunity, because being a PhD scholar, to present and take corrections from such resourceful panel itself is in fact a privilege for me. So moving on to the as a brief introduction, I would like to go through three basic questions. First of all, what are business cycles? And in order to quote Burns and Mitchell, business cycles are a type of fluctuations found in the aggregate economic activity of nations. And it has become a major characteristic of any market economy in this era. In the Indian setting, it is more useful to think it in terms of growth cycles. Now, why do we need to map business cycles? Identification of the periodicity and turning points of these cycles are critical inputs in policy action in order to bring back the economic system to the desired path. And regarding business cycle modeling, beginning with the seminal work of dating and forecasting and the construction of the composite index of lead indicators by NBER, during the last two decades, several new techniques have been employed that have produced new insights into the literature. Although various linear time series techniques are employed, many of the fundamental linear approaches to business cycle research are incapable of capturing business cycle asymmetries. Consequently, there has been interest in nonlinear specifications. Now, prior to 1980s, the Indian economy was primarily driven by monsoons, whereas devaluation of rupee and transition to a market determined exchange rate were the key features of the decade of 1990. Fluctuating oil prices, volatility of global GDP growth, current account deficits, etc., also contributed much to the fluctuations of recent decades. This in turn led to the emergence of conventional cyclical pattern in India's economic growth. Thus, growth cycle measurement and government's response to the same are particularly important for the recent decades. Now, failure of many macro models to foresee and forecast the upcoming cyclical phases might be attributed to difficulties in modeling the changing nature of the economy using the linear approaches, thereby requiring a more complex and high frequency model frameworks. Also, COVID-19 has spread rapidly across the globe, and its impact is now felt by almost every country, with India as no exception. So, understanding the devastating impact of this pandemic on the economic growth and the way out of it, prerequisite information about the state of affairs when we were actually hit in the beginning. So moving on to the objectives of study, the first and foremost objective of our paper is on a quarterly basis for the time period between 1982 quarter 2 to 2020 quarter 4. All these years are in financial years. To compute the average growth rate during recessions and expansions, and computing the average duration of the cyclical episodes by identifying the transition probabilities of regime shifting is also attempted. Apart from that, estimation of regime shifting fiscal policy role is also done in this study. Now, moving on to the methodology of the study, we have adopted the regime switching Markov model of Hamilton, which was proposed in his 1989 paper, with two-state autoregressive model with four lags. Basically, it is an MS2 AR4 model and is given by the following equation. Here, the variable YT is nothing but 100 times the change in log of real GDP, and 51, 52, 53, and 54 are the coefficients of autoregressive terms, and EST is the error term, and USD being the state dependent term. The state variable SD follows a two-state first-order Markov process, and its transition probability matrix is given by P11, P21, P12, and P22. P11 is nothing but the probability of being in state 1, given that the system was already in state 1 in the previous period. Likewise, P21 is nothing but the probability of being in state 1, given that in the previous period the system was in regime 2. Thus, P12 is the probability of going from state 1 to state 2, and P21 is the probability of going from state 2 to state 1. So, being said that, the expected duration of regime can be calculated from the following formula. That is, duration can be calculated by, suppose, condition on being in state 2, duration can be calculated by 1 minus P22 raised to minus 1, which is nothing but P21 raised to minus 1. And for fiscal policy rule, we have adopted the specification put forward by David and Lieper in their 2007 paper. And T is the tax revenue, YT is the output gap, and DT minus 1 is the back debt, and GT is the government expenditure. And all these variables are expressed as percentage to GDP. Here, the variable of interest is gamma 2. Fiscal policy is termed as active or passive based on gamma 2. As per Lieper, a regime is termed as active if 1 minus gamma 2 is greater than 0. Now, moving on to the data sources, we have used data from 1982 quarter 2 to 2020 quarter 4. And data prior to 2011 was taken by using the back series data published by CSO, but it was in annual frequency. So we had to convert it into quarterly frequency by using the Shaolin max log method. And for that, we have used a index of industrial production as an indicator series. And then the entire GDP data set is used to estimate the Markov switching MS2AR4 model. And for estimating the regime shifting fiscal policy rule, data on tax revenue, central government debt, and expenditure as well were obtained from CAC database. And due to the data availability issues of fiscal variables, our regime switching analysis is restricted to the period of 2001 quarter 2 to 2021 quarter 3. Now, moving on to the empirical part of the paper, let's start with a quick overview of India's growth experience during the last 4 decades. And it is evident from the graph that the GDP growth rate is actually declining for the last 15 quarters, except for the last 2 quarters of 2018, and has reached 3.01% in the last quarter of 2020. And from this table, we can see that the decadal growth rates, it has been actually increasing over the last 4 decades, but the alarming thing is that for the last 12 to 15 quarters, continuously our growth rate is actually declining. An interesting thing to point out here is actually given by Dr. Rangarajan and Dr. Srivastava in their 2020 article that due to the demonetization which was implemented in November 2016 and the rollout of GST implementation in 2017, along with the global growth slowdown, might have had some destructive effects on the economy. Here, this table shows the estimated regime specific parameters of our fourth order autoregressive Markov model, and namely the intercepts, standard deviation, and autoregressive coefficients, etc. Here, the output indicates that the regime represented by SD is equal to 0, that is, the contractional regime. During that contractional regime, the average growth rate is alpha 0, that is 3.94% per quarter. While during the expansionary regime, the average growth rate is alpha 1, which is 7.77%. The estimation results indicate that the probability that the expansion will be followed by another quarter of expansion is very likely, with probability being P22, which is 0.80. And this regime will typically persist for around 5 quarters, which is 1 year and almost 3 months. Sorry. Similarly, the probability that the contraction will be followed by another quarter of expansion, which is P12, is 0.21. And this regime will persist on an average for a little over 1 quarter. It is interesting to observe here that the persistence of both the expansionary and contractionary regime is approximately same, around 5 quarters, and both the duration of transition phases, that is P12 and P21, shows that the Indian business cycle possesses the characteristics of having less than 4 month duration of high and low growth regimes. Here, the smoothest probabilities of contraction and expansion is depicted. And from these smooth probabilities, we have mapped the turning points for the business cycle, which is summarized in the next slide. Here, 13 growth cycles of various durations have been identified for the overall period. And it is evident from the table that the average duration of expansion is around 6 quarters, whereas the average duration of contraction is around 5 quarters. And the duration of whole cycle is 11 quarters, which is less than 3 years. And most of the existing studies in the literature have used either monthly or quarterly data of IAP or some battery of other economic macroeconomic variables to identify the turning points of such business cycles. So comparing our results with the existing studies is actually limited in scope, but still we can see that in the paper I have summarized that most of the peaks and troughs identified in our analysis is identified in the previous existing literature as well. Now, the dynamic predictions of real GDP is given in this figure, and the vertical dotted line shows from where our out-of-forecast analysis has begun. And this is also a small attempt to see the hysteresis effect, that is the long-term effect of short-term shocks, although we have just considered just a 5 years prediction only. And it shows that in the absence of COVID-19, the Indian economy would have been growing by 6.14% in 2021. In fact, in the NCAR quarterly review of Indian economy published in September 2020, it was also projected that a 5.8% growth rate for India in the absence of COVID-19. Also, as can be seen for the subsequent year, still 2024-25, the growth rate would be consistently below 6% level. An important note of caution here, which we have to keep in mind, is that this estimate does not account for the impact of recent pandemic on the economy, since the sample period is restricted up to 2020 March. Again, with the second COVID-19 wave, which was actually 4 times greater in ferocity compared to the first wave, both in terms of number of cases and death, has further disrupted the growth process, which had already been severely damaged by the first wave. Now, the threatening third wave also possesses further downward pressure on the growth process. In this aspect, we would like to look at the regime switching fiscal policy route as well. Here, the estimated transition probabilities and regime duration shows that the active fiscal policy regime is more persistent with 8 quarter duration than the passive fiscal policy regime for India, which is less than a year, which is around 3 quarters on an average. And as can be seen, the government has spent without bothering much about the debt accumulation during the past and majority of the period. And regime one is considered as passive fiscal policy regime, as the government response to lack debt is comparatively larger as compared to regime two. Also, another interesting thing is that in passive fiscal policy regime, the government tax revenue has responded positively to output gap and the government expenditure as well. So in order to conclude, we can say that to recover from the unprecedented disruption of 2 consecutive years due to COVID-19 and the fact that the economy was already in a contractionary phase when we were hit by the COVID-19 pandemic, the growth process now needs a strong expansionary macroeconomic push. And as we all know, the macro intervention by the central bank was very well appreciated and almost exhausted. And this calls for higher expenditure growth and higher fiscal stimulus from the government path. Coming on to the limitations of the study, this is a univariate MS model for growth cycle. We could have taken more than one variable for analyzing the business cycle turning points. Also, we could have taken more than 2 regimes as well. And one of the important limitations is that this stands as the first attempt to use the back-series data and temporal disaggregation to identify the business cycle turning points as well. and typical data liability issues related to macroeconomic modeling is also applicable to our study. Thank you.
Thank you, Marty. You know, it's perfect. You know, particularly I enjoyed that emphasis on hysteresis analysis. You know, I'll get back to that question later.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, and actually, I have read articles which you have written also regarding the hysteresis, and it was interesting.
Yeah, we will discuss in the Q&A. And now I invite Ranjan Kumar Mohanty to discuss Matthew's paper. And of course, there are a lot of methodological things about HP filter and all. We can, you know, talk when I open the floor, because that's quite a concern about the output gap, which was highlighted by, you know, keynote speaker Clemens Hughes also yesterday. We will take it up. Over to you, Ranjan.
Good morning to all of you. First of all, I would like to congratulate Matthew for his excellent presentation. This is a very well-written paper. They have used the appropriate econometric technique for examining their objectives. In this paper, a Markov regime switching autoregressive model is estimated for the Indian economy. They have used quarterly data from 1982 Q1 to 2020 Q4. Results indicate that average growth rate of real GDP in India during expansion is nearly 8%, like 7.77. So during recession, it is 3.94%. And each state, this expansion and recession, they are persistent. It is very interesting. Average duration of both the regime are approximately same. Business cycle average duration is 11 quarter. I don't want to discuss here all other details because the author has already presented in details. I have few observations. The paper finds that the active fiscal policy regime is more persistent than the passive fiscal policy regime for India. So it would be better if the author give a clarificatory note on this active and passive fiscal policy in a footnote at least, which will be very easily understood by the general reader, because it is one of the major findings of the study. The second observation is, like, the innovation or the originality of the paper is not that sufficient, because if you want to publish in a good index journal, they will definitely look for this original contribution of the paper. So this paper is relatively similar with the Ahmad and Kamaya paper 2010. Only exception is that data period is extended and you have used the back series of GDP. I hope they have used the same quarterly data and the IIP. So, and the methodology, this Markov switching regression methodology, is also similar. So you have to think about it and try to adopt what is your original contribution in the paper, so that it will be very appealing for the good index journal when you will publish it. So, and the issue is, another issue is with the use of your GDP data. Means, like, if I am not wrong, after 2011-12 base year, GDP data is available like GVA at basic price. And earlier it was GDP at factor cost. So you have used both GVA at basic price and GDP at factor cost. So it has some difference. It is not exactly same, GDP at factor cost and GDP at basic price. So please justify this in the paper, maybe data limitation like this, you have to justify in the paper. So, and another thing is that when you decompose this annual data, because we don't have this quarterly back series data, so when you decompose, you have used Chow-Lin method. So for robustness, I will ask that why Chow-Lin, Chow and Lin method? Why not the other methods like Denton method or Litterman methods? So why Chow and Lin is superior to this Denton Litterman is there, you have to justify in the paper. Like similarly for this regression regime switching regression, you have used this fourth order autoregressing term. So for reverseness check, try to use the second order, third order. So if the result is same, so it will be very robust to your. Else you justify why did you choose this fourth order. Fourth order is for annual data, fourth order is like people will make questions. So it will be better if you justify it with second order autoregressive, third order autoregressive, like that. And once I also found some typo error in your specifying especially the data period. For example, in the data section, in some places you have, let just a minute. You have mentioned that high frequency available data, issues of fiscal regime switching analysis, fiscal policy is restricted to the period of 2001 Q2 to 2021 Q3. So like similarly in before the table 6, this estimate does not account for the impact of recent pandemic on economy since the sample period is restricted up to 2020 March. So it means it is 2019 Q4. So try to look at this, whether it is a typo error or you have done it for the empirical analysis, try to justify that. So, and another thing is that regarding the your policy suggestion, regarding the counter fiscal policy, you know, India has already crossed its 60% GDP. Now it is nearly, I think, 90% of GDP. I am not sure. Nearly touches 90% of GDP. So what would be its implication if you suggest counter fiscal policy for debt sustainability and inflation, which is due to fiscal price theory of fiscal price level? So this debt sustainability and inflation in the coming year. So try to justify this implication. And I have some, like, your prediction has not covered the data beyond March 2020. You have already mentioned it. So how far it is reliable, this prediction, without considering the pandemic phase? So I just wonder. And also, like, you have taken some cutoff stage, 5% for this prediction and all things. So how did it come? So please look into this. And last thing is that why this Markov switching regression model? Because it has already used by Ahmad and Miller. Why don't you use this Markov switching vector autoregressive model? So because business cycle is very complex. It is not determined by itself. It is not autoregressive. It can be happened due to various other macro variables. So if you incorporate other macro variables in a VAR format, this regime switching, Markov switching vector autoregressive format, so that will be very nice. So that's it. So I'm done, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So Matthew, note down all the points by Renjan. You know, when I talk to the young scholars, you know, your targets, like, one, to get it published in journal, when you go through that process, when you go through the review process, what kind of comments and all you get, and, you know, the kind of your thought process to get it to a journal, that is one question. And young scholars also think about the policy research and the policy impacts. So these are, you know, two words, and I prefer to join the think tank from the university. And, you know, when I do the work, everybody asks me the policy impacts. So it's interesting the way, you know, youngsters work on your paper, you know, go through the review process with the journal, and, you know, another set of scholars think about the policy impacts. So Matthew, you think about all these things, and I will get back to you after the presentation by Amandeep on ecological fiscal transfers and state level budgetary spending in India. That's fine, right, Matthew? Over to you. I mean, after.
Sure, ma'am. Sure, yeah. Definitely, ma'am.
Okay. Amandeep, go ahead.
I'm trying to share my slides. Are you able to see them?
You can make it into, you know. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So my slides are visible, right? Hello?
Go ahead. Yeah. It's perfect. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So now distracting you all from the past couple of slides on sanctions, fiscal policy, business cycles. Our paper, Ecological Fiscal Transfers and State-Level Budgetary Spending in India, analyzes the flypaper effects. This paper is, of course, a joint work with Ranjan Kumar Mohanty, he's my former colleague, and now with Exaham University. Lekha Chakraborty needs no formal introduction. And Divi Ranjan is also from NIPSP. So moving forward, I'll give you a brief outline of my presentation. In fact, our presentation, I'll set in the context by giving you a backdrop and then reviewing the literature, following up with research questions and methodology results. Then will be discussed by Ranjan, who is already there in the audience. And then conclusions and policy implications will be then followed by Divi, who will end the presentation. So Moving ahead, reaping the benefits of fiscal decentralization, many countries are now focused on environmental commitment also at the subnational level, keeping the principle of subsidiarity in mind that says that responsibility to provide a certain service should be assigned to the jurisdiction which is closest to people. So while following a principle, there may be some other contradictions with it, that specifically talking about inter-jurisdictional competition here, that means that when the jurisdictions try to, they follow lax environmental standards in order to attract mobile capital, what they actually do is that they, this leads to subnational, suboptimal decisions on environmental quality. And also we see that there is a lot of inefficient environmental standards that are set up across nationally after that. Then that itself tells you the race to bottom scenarios and creation of pollution havens. But empirical evidence definitely shows a continuous tension between principle of subsidiarity and race to bottom. So in that case, government tries to internalize these externalities through legal negotiations or using fiscal instruments. So in putting that in perspective, intergovernmental fiscal transfers then come into picture as a savior, where the government uses it as a technique to internalize such externalities. So why now intergovernmental fiscal transfers are important is that these intergovernmental transfers, they help to cull out the effect of the local public spending in total for the subnational government. Because, it not only internalizes, it not only, corrects the horizontal imbalances that are occurring due to fiscal needs and fiscal capacity differences, also the vertical imbalances that occur due to differences in the your functions of the different tiers of government and so far. So when you talk about intergovernmental fiscal transfers importance, then the concept of flypaper effect also gets highlighted. So the simple narrative about flypaper effect is that it means that money stick where it hits. To put it in other simple words, I would say that when you have a higher income, when there is a higher income intergovernmental transfer, and it leads to a stronger rise in expenditure as compared to when that same rise in expenditure is not derived from the other sources. So theoretically, it was believed that an increase in the public spending due to increase in transfers has the same impact if there, that same spending is there from an increase in the income of that state or maybe the median voters of the same jurisdiction. But however, empirically, it has been established that with the change in the intergovernmental transfer, there is much more rise in the spending on public goods than the rise in the income of the individual of states. Because there, one thing is that transfer financed public expenditure, they are way more cheaper than financed through the state's own income. So when we talk about flypaper effect, there still remains a paradox for this effect, because, and it has been in the prominent debate while talking about the impact of fiscal transfer. Why? Because effects also get impacted by other factors such as political or bureaucratic reasons behind that. Maybe some political people try to, cut the budget or do something with it. So also the flypaper effect is can vary subject to the type of intergovernmental grants and expenditure. So also in that case, when we talk about India, there is a very limited number of empirical research done particularly in this perspective. There's one paper by Lalwani in 2000 that discussed the discussed the effect of existence of the flypaper effect in India, and they find evidence for the same as well. But those effect was tested for the 11th Finance Commission recommendations. Many of you in the panel now, right now, in the participants in the audience already know about Finance Commission as an institution and what is all it is done by them. So clearly, when we are talking about flypaper effect in our paper, we are trying to look at the policy backdrop from the 14th Finance Commission and 15th Finance Commission, which is now currently into picture. Why? Because these commissions, they were the first ever commissions to integrate the environmental variable into the tax transfer formula, which is designed by the Finance Commission itself, that integrated an environment variable with a weight of 7.5%. Taking this move forward, 15th Finance Commission, when it tabled its report on 15th Feb 2021, also increased the criterion, in fact, to 10% in the unconditional fiscal transfer using the variable dense forest cover interstate data. Such a move is very welcoming because when you talk about climate change commitments, then the role of the national government and the subnational government has to go hand in hand. That means, you know, this is an example of cooperative federalism also in that perspective, because ecology and forest cover, they both are shared subjects for both union and state governments. Also, when you are trying to, you're trying to fulfill your global commitments to reduce your emissions, like for India to within intensity by 33-35% by 2030 compared to 2005 levels. In that perspective, we see that the intergovernmental fiscal transfer can play a very major role, particularly the ecological fiscal transfer in this regard can play a very important role complying with the climate change commitments that we are already into. So given that, this leads to our research question where we will try to answer the effect of transfers on the forest expenditure. Also, how these transfers have been integrated into the environmental variables, and also directly coming onto the existence of flypaper effect for India, given the 15th Finance Commission recommendations and previous 14th Finance Commission recommendations. So putting that into perspective, I'll just request Ranjan to take forward the presentations by discussing the data methodology and the estimation techniques, and then Divi can end the presentation. Thank you. Over to you, Ranjan.
Thank you, Aman. Yeah. You please share the slide because
Yes.
As discussed, the objective of the paper is to examine the flypaper effects in the ecological fiscal spending at subnational level in India. Slide, Aman. So, for the empirical analysis, we have used the data of 27 Indian states, which excluded the newly formed Telangana states and the excluded states like Jammu and Kashmir. So that's why we have 27 Indian states. And we have used the annual data from 2003 to 2019. Why 2003? Because all the forest cover data that is continuously available from 2003 onwards. So that's why our data starting point is 2003. So in this study, we have used the data related to various type of public receipts and expenditures, forest cover and population, which we have used. To be specific, the public expenditure variables include all the total expenditure on ecology, revenue expenditure on ecology, and capital expenditure on ecology. Similarly, the public receipt variables, that is our state-owned revenue receipts, which includes both tax and non-tax revenue, as well as the total transfers, which includes the share in central tax and central grants. And the data on forest cover, it includes the medium dense forest cover and very dense forest cover. So this population data that have been collected from the report of the technical group on population projection by the National Commission on Population, all these receipt and expenditure, public expenditure variables that have been sourced from the state respective budget documents, and this forest cover data that has been mapped from the Indian state of forest reports. So in this panel setup, our major dependent variables are three. One is state level total expenditure on forest, revenue expenditure on forest, and capital expenditure on forest. Our independent variables are like total transfer to the state government, total state's own revenue, population, medium dense forest cover, and very dense forest cover. Come next. So given the data structure, we apply the appropriate economic technique, that is final regression, which includes fixed and random effect models, for verifying our objectives. So in this model one, what I can say that this I, small I, represents all the states, 27 states. T refers to our time period. So this, our dependent variable, YT, represents all the ecological fiscal spending that I told in the previous slide. The ZT is our variable of interest. Here it includes two variables. One is total transport to the state government. Another is the state's own tax revenue, And this XT, it is the other selected explanatory variables in like the population, very dense forest cover, medium dense forest cover, so all these things. So beta is here, all the constant and intercept, and this lambda is like our the variables which have been excluded in the model, which is invariant in time. Okay, so basically we are interested in the Z component, like the variable of our interest is total transport to the state government and state own revenue. A priori, we expect that higher total transport to state government and state's own revenue are expected to have a positive impact on ecological fiscal spending. So to be specific, we have three dependent variables, and each dependent variable have two equations. One equation with medium dense forest cover, another equation with very dense cover. So as a whole, we have only six models. Okay. Come on, next. So this is the results with our medium dense forest cover. So in this results, the first column, which is for the total expenditure on forest, then revenue expenditure on forest, and CEF is the capital expenditure on forest. So as expected, we can see that the total transfer component like TRF and state's own revenue like SOR, they have a positive and a highly significant impact on aggregate ecological expenditure. However, the coefficient of total transfer, it is higher than the coefficient of state. So this confirms the existence of flypaper effect in India. While disaggregating this total expenditure on forest into revenue expenditure on forest and capital expenditure, that is in this table, it is model 3 and 4, we also find the presence of flypaper effect in both of these models, because the coefficient of TRF is greater than the state own revenue. So if you see the cause,
it's 1 minute, okay? This could 1 minute, okay?
Okay. So this this could be because of committed revenue expenditure that the state government is bounded with, and also diverting capital expenditure due to modified tax devolution formula by recent financial commission. So given the budget constraint, it shows that more transport to state government help in financing the revenue capital and capital expenditure and fiscal spending. Another one interesting result that this model gives us, that the coefficient of total transports in model 4, like capital spending, it is higher than the model 2 and 3. So what does it imply? This implies that aggregate transfer, if the aggregate transfer increases to states, then the state will allocate more capital spending on forest. So Aman, next. This is the last slide for my side. So this is also exactly the same result what we got in MDF. So this is the result with VDF. The selected models also present a strong flypaper effect, as the coefficient of total transfer is more than the coefficient of state's own revenue. So this effect is also prevalent for the revenue expenditure and capital expenditure on forests. This result also supports the earlier findings of higher transfers, and that motivates the state government to spend more on capital ecological spending. So as a whole, our empirical analysis shows that we found a strong existence of flypaper effect across all the models. Over to you, DV. Divi,
we can't hear you. Unmute.
Sorry. So I'll just quickly wrap it up in 30 seconds. So as Ranjan has well mentioned, our model show a significant flypaper effect on the subnational ecological spending. We have control for demographic and geographical variables, disentangling the total tax transfers over current and capital expenditures. Evidence of stimulus have been found to both revenue and capital expenditures on forests with increase in tax transfers than the increase in the state's income. We have included the inclusion and dropping of these control variables also reconfirm the existence of the consistency in the model and support the occurrence of the flypaper effects. This study well supports the recommendation by the 15th Finance Commission of the inclusion of the forest and ecology indicator with a 10% weightage. I'm on the next slide, please. And talking about the policy implications, the environmental fiscal transfers do incentivize an increase in the state forestry budgets, which also leads to a statewide coordination in the decrease of the carbon emissions from the current prevailing levels of 6 to 7%. And with the increase of environmental fiscal transfers 7.5% to 10% by the 14th Finance Commission to the 15th Finance Commission, leaves a precedent that if there is a need, it can be further increased to meet the global commitments. So thank you so much. I'd like to conclude that.
Thank you so much. Now I invite Zina to discuss about the paper. Over to you.
Thank you. Let me share you this. Can you see my screen?
No.
No. Now?
No, we can't see.
Okay.
Yeah, it's perfect.
Yeah? Okay. First of all, I want to say thank you for your great presentation. I know that it's a working paper that you want to improve it, definitely. And you know, at the relationship between fiscal decentralization and the ecological issues was very interesting and informative for me. And the advantages of your essay was being a very practical and useful topic, especially to improve environmental policies to deal with climate change, using six estimations to ensure the robustness of results, using scatter plots to depict the relationship between variables. However, I have some questions about the econometrics part. In the stage of before estimation, I want to know that do you use some tests for checking the stationary of your data by using unit root test or co-integration test if it's needed? And in the estimation process, I was looking for finding some tests like F-limer to determining using pooled data or pooled model or fixed model, and also for Hausmann test that is just reported for two of your estimations. And after estimations, I was looking for some tests to make them to make us ensure about the autocorrelation, or for example, Durbin-Watson test, and about the multicollinearity VIF test or white test for heteroscedasticity. And also, I have some suggestion for you. Maybe it's better, I would think that it's better to explain more about theoretical and empirical frameworks of your model. And maybe it's better to adding a table of descriptive statistics, including mean, median, standard deviation. And also in concluding part, interpreting the result of all variables, including control variables, except coefficients based on expected coefficient based on previous study, and whether the results are in line with or not. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Zina. So this was like the young scholar session we had in this international conference. And let me open the floor. We have now 11:20. So we have 20 more minutes to discuss, you know, and then I get back to the authors to speak around 2 to 3 minutes in response to, you know, the questions asked by discussant and the you know, other participants. Quickly, I have four questions. I just quickly ask you. You know, I'm taking that, you know, what is a liberty to ask you first. Zeina, of course, you know, in the context of Iran, I can understand that in your model, you control for deals, the corruption. You know, this is an important issue in the context of India also, that deals affect inequality, it affects development. And the way you have proxied that deals, the corruption in your model, if you can slightly explain to that process, it will be great. Because inequality, it's not just because of the widening, you know, income, but it's also because of the deals and the corruption, how it affects a country. So you can just explain a bit about that corruption part, because we want to model it in, you know, that deals part, but it's quite a tough thing how to, you know, quantify the deals. So that you may explain. And a quick question to Matthew and to Magulsha, your methodology, of course, we senior scholars don't have an answer to this about, you know, the way you look into that output gap and the, you know, that HP filter. It's not that we senior scholars, because in the recent write-up by Romer also, he mentioned that there is no silver bullet. I am asking this question about the limitations of HP filter. The moment you take out the trend and, you know, the cycles and call the trend, that process, have you come across, when you read the literature, econometric literature, a better methodology to it? Because we are using HP filter, because it's not as a sophistication, but I know that. So I thought that I will ask young scholars, do you have a better methodology to capture this other than HP filter? Because we are continually using the methodology on HP filter. Then, of course, Matthew's presentation I enjoyed on, you know, your emphasis on the hysteresis. And maybe that output gap and the business cycles part you can explain, because in the context of emerging economies, that article by, you know, Geeta Govinda, that cyclist trend, there is no strict, you know, presence of business cycles. That is one school of thought. But other school of thought, like, you know, what we have done, we date the cycles, right? We date what is the ups and, you know, what's the down. We date the business cycles. So what's your view on that? But you have quite balanced your paper by using the hysteresis analytical framework. So I'm not questioning you, because these, even the senior scholars who are in this field for 20 years or 15 years, we're also thinking aloud. So I thought that I'll ask this question to young scholars. And yeah, these are the cute questions. And of course, regarding Magulsha's paper, that question about external and internal, and you know, as yesterday pointed out by Clement's views, you grow out of your public debt, you know, in the low interest rate regime. So when you talk about the debt sustainability, how you interpret it, because we can always grow out of it, right? That RNG and your model, that is extremely relevant, but you can explain a bit more about it. And now floor is open and I invite your questions to talk to the scholars and chat box. Of course, I can see a question by Vipasha Ray. Oh no, that was a technical thing. And Nitya's question, how do you explain the lower relative magnitude of coefficient of SOR when COR is the dependent variable? I think these, you know, SOR and CEF, I think Renjan can answer that question. Okay, this is related to that ecological fiscal transfers paper. Now, the floor is open. Questions are welcome. Yeah.
Can I ask a question?
Pinaki, go ahead.
Yes. It will be nice to, it's a clarificatory question. It will be nice to know what is active fiscal policy and what is passive fiscal policy. I think that was the paper on, you know, debt sustainability and business cycle, right? So that is one thing that I thought if the author could clarify.
Thank you. You know, even
another question that I had with respect to the paper on, you know, ecological fiscal transfer is also, it will be it will be good to give some, you know, basic data that you have collected graphically, so that we understand what has happened in the last 13, 14 years, yes, almost 20 years, because you are having data on 20 from 2003 on forest cover. And also it will be good to explain and control for, I don't know whether it has been done in the paper, but at least in the presentation, from the presentation I couldn't understand, it must be there in the paper, is have you controlled for other interventions that are simultaneously working to increase forest cover, say the policies that the state governments adopt, central government rules, maybe a you know, mapping and documentation of that could further strengthen the paper and help in understanding how this impact is separated out from the other impacts. You have control for many things, but an explanation and having a mapping of policies and plotting it against the increase or change in forest cover will be very, very important contribution. Thank you.
I have a question also.
Yes, sir.
I have a question. If you.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
This is also on the paper on ecology and transfers related to that. See, in the 15th FC, what we found was that the states which had the maximum very dense and moderately dense forests, that is particularly in the northeast. So the forest survey results indicated a decline in the total forest cover, whereas it showed a rise. So this is a very paradoxical situation, because these are the states which are supposed to have benefited the maximum from the 14th FC dispensation. So it was a bit counterintuitive that way. And I also like to add to what Pinaki mentioned about the other interventions. You see, one major intervention which is there is through this process, this funding through CAMPA. Now, that is a major driver of investments in forest area, particularly for replantation, regeneration of forests, etc. And you know about CAMPA, so I don't want to add. So this perhaps will, if you look at these aspects also, it'll enrich your paper and make it more comprehensive, because these two commissions have done a lot in this area, and these needed to be sustained in future also. So otherwise, thank you very much. It was a very well structured and well argued paper.
So much, sir. Questions? Okay, now we have only 10 minutes left, and we have four, you know, authors to speak to you. And of course, Divi, Divi has done the scatter plots, which Pinaki has the concerns for, and we have not presented here, but Divi, may you can, you know, talk about it. And a quick point on Pinaki's passive and active policy. I was wondering whether you meant it in a way that who is getting the first mover advantage. You know, that's a sort of literature where, you know, whether the first mover advantage is done by fiscal policy or monetary policy, and you call it as unpleasant monetary arithmetic if it is the first mover advantage is for the fiscal policymaker, and you call it as unpleasant fiscal arithmetic if you're going for the central bank. I don't know whether it is from the fiscal monetary policy linkages, but over to you. First, I will give the chance to Senat to, you know, answer to the concerns raised, and then Magusha, Matthews, and Amandeep, and TV, and Ranjit.
Can you hear me? Excuse me?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I want to start by Magusha comments. Actually, the sanctions countries are spread all around the world, and most of them have missing data in their variable, like GDP. in some regions, for example, they involve in war. So I had a limitation to choose a smaller group of countries with enough data. For example, if I want to concentrate on the MENA regions, Syria, Iraq, and Libya that experience sanctions have a huge amount of missing data, so I had to expand the sample size. Furthermore, because of some evidence that a single product economy, they can be more affected on sanctions, I decided to choose them. And also, I didn't find a specific index to clarify resource-based countries. I had to use natural resource rent and its average to choose my countries. And, you know, I have some problem with my internet connection. I missed some parts of your comments, but I hear that you asked me explaining about the corruption. Is it correct, ma'am?
That's right. Go ahead. Yeah.
I use corruption as a control variable in my paper because corruption can affect allocated proportion of spending between economic sector. The disallocation effect is usually in favor of some sector like fuel, energy, cultural, and defense, and at the expenses of health, education, and social sectors. So I modify the variable of control of corruption in such a way that it's directly reflect the amount of corruption, and I expected that it had a negative impact on government health expenditure per capita, but surprisingly in some models that its coefficients was significant, it has a positive effect, and I think that it's maybe because of this fact that corruption can add another extra cost to any contracts, or in this way it can have a positive effect on government expenditure. And I can't hear, but I just say some words about business cycle. Am I right? You know. Hello. Can you hear me?
You're asking. Okay.
Yeah. You know, because of my internet connection was interrupted, I didn't hear all of your comments.
We will be doing the correspondence one to one. We can do it bilateral later. Don't worry. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Done. Oh, you have some more points? Done. Okay. Okay. Now let me invite Magusha. Magusha.
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am? Ma'am, can you hear me, ma'am? Hello?
Yeah, yes, I can hear you.
Thank you. To respond to the first question, where regarding whether there are some other factors that could be more, more country-specific factors that could have been considered, it is really true that given the BRICS is a very diverse group and with it's not a group based on geometric proximity, so this is a very diverse group. So so there is a limitation where it can capture the a unique model, a single model capturing all the factors that could have been contributed to this primary surplus. There is a limitation to that, but as far as we are considering the time series model, so we could in fact claim that to some extent the individuality of the economies have been incorporated in this model. But still, even then, there is still the possibility to analyze the channels through which the debt has been, the borrowing funds has been utilized, and how this has been able to create primary surpluses in different economies. That scope for research is still open. So that is a very valid point to take in, and we are actually trying to incorporate that in our research. But the major problem we face there is the data availability for all the economies there is a lot of restrictions on the data that is available for us. But still, we are trying to capture some major factors that could have been the major influence in the development of these economies. And also, while coming to the HFP filter value, it's true, ma'am. HFP filter is very we can say it's a conventional method of retrending. But here, since I in the beginning of the presentation, this was just a preliminary analysis that for us. So I just want to make sure that how the debt sustainability analysis can be carried forward with that. So for the time being, we have resorted to the HP filter techniques. So, but definitely I'm taking your suggestion to look into some other ways where these trends can be captured more more clearly in the analysis. And regarding the debt sustainability part also, yes, for considering that we can't claim that 100% that the data that we receive is very pure. So the debt sustainability for India, for example, when we take external debt as sustainable, but public debt is unsustainable. So there are some mismatches. This could be explained in different ways. So each economy's social macroeconomic factors are all contributing to these factors as well. And to respond to Sir's question on active and passive fiscal policy, for this paper as such, we haven't considered the active and passive policy impacts as such for this debt sustainability, but that also is a possibility open there. So if you are asking me what is active and passive fiscal policy, I would like to say that an active fiscal policy is where the government is trying to respond to some macroeconomic issues that is there in the economy so that situation can be made under control. But passive fiscal policy is that you don't change the rule as such, but you you keep the rule as such and try to incorporate whatever the policies are there in that. Thank you.
Now over to Matthews.
Yeah, thanks, ma'am. Due to the time constraint, I will move quickly to respond to the first series of questions and suggestions put forward by Ranjan sir. And it was actually really helpful for me as well, being the PhD scholar, so I can improve upon that. And I'm really thankful for that. And most of the suggestions I will consider and improve myself. And regarding the GDP data, yes, after 2011 also, we have used quarterly GDP data. In the new base year. And regarding the fourth order, why the fourth order AR regression was used, that lag selection criteria, we actually used AIC and SBIC criteria for that. And another thing was that regarding the data period, one confusion sir has raised, it was actually not a typo error. In fact, for the business cycle, dating and mapping, I have used data from 1982 to 2020. But for the fiscal policy regime shifting analysis from 2001 to 2021, quarter three was used, until December 2020, data has been used for the fiscal policy regime shifting method. And the policy suggestion and the corrections which he suggested was really helpful, and I will incorporate that in my future improvement. And regarding the important issue which ma'am has raised regarding the output gap and the HP filtering, lot of biasness issues and backdrops are there when we are using this traditional filtering methods, and HP filter is no different from that. One interesting paper which have come across, which somewhere tried to address these issues of biasness and all of these historical statistical filters, was by Barendra Kumar Boy and Harendra Kumar Behra. It is titled India's Potential Output Revisited. It was published in the year 2016. They tried to estimate this potential output and output gap using a battery of statistical filters, including HP filter, CF filter, BK, and BN filters as well, and also the production function as well. And then using the principal component analysis, they have estimated a composite index for this output gap. It was actually rather interesting for me. And other than that, I couldn't find, that's actually a drawback. I couldn't find any other thing which really addresses the drawback of this HP filter and all. And Yes, another interesting thing which was put forward by Lekha ma'am was the article by Gita from the IIM of ma'am. It was regarding the output gap and business cycle. Yes, I have come across that from your own article, co-authored with Amandeep ma'am. Yeah, I can recollect that in. In that article written by Geeta Gopinath ma'am, it was actually an interesting view regarding the potential output and output gap is actually put forward. It is said that business cycle is always not a cycle. Sometimes the cycle itself is a trend, and all such new aspect of view of output gap and potential output estimation is actually put forward. It was really interesting. Yeah, I think I have covered almost.
Okay. Thank you, Matthew. Over to you, Amandeep.
Thank you, Dr. Lekha. First of all, I want to thank Dr. Pinaki and Dr. Mr. A. N. Jha for the very useful and rich comments on our paper. Definitely, we could incorporate your suggestion on putting the data graphically for the last 20 years and definitely see what's the pattern, and also mapping the programs. Another very important suggestion by Mr. Jha about CAMPA funds, we really need to look onto that also. So we'll take as a very useful suggestion and try to incorporate in our paper. The another question about that came in the chat box, I'd like Ranjan, would you like to answer that question? And also yeah. Thank you, Zainab, also for your useful discussions on our paper. I'll let Ranjan speak about that with you.
Yeah, quickly, because we ran out of time. It's 11:42. Quickly.
Yes.
Okay. So regarding the unit root and co-integration test, we could do that test because I'm more fascinated towards that. But given the data structure of our analysis, that does not allow us to do that test, because for panel co-integration test, the minimum condition is the time period that should be greater than the number of observation n. So t should be greater than n. In our case, our t is only 17 and n is greater than n is 27. So we could not do that. So unit root for taking the unit root for 10 to 15 years data, it is not required. So that's why we did not do that. And regarding Hausman test, Applimer test, we did that, but that is not shown in the paper. Before taking the fixed effect and random effect, we completed that. And regarding this descriptive and the theoretical empirical and
federal
paper, we just 2 days before we finished another draft of that. So that has included all these things. So due to time constraint, we did not share
in Okay, Renjan. You know, I understand that. It's, you know, so let's move to the next session by you know, Pola Profita, and thank you so much for the brilliant presentations, and thank you so much for enriching discussions by Mr. A.M. Jha and Pinaki. Thank you so much. Now let's go to the next session and wish you all the best, all the scholars, and we will be in touch. Thank you so
much. Everyone.
Thank you, ma'am, for providing such a great opportunity.
Thank you so much. Wish you all the best. You.